Hi, my name is Hunter Foster. I'm the artistic director for the Red House Art Center here in Syracuse, New York. And thanks so much for joining us tonight for another edition of Red Talks. That's right. I used to be a theater director, and now I'm a host of an online television show. That's right. That's where we are these days, folks. So I hope everyone is staying safe and doing well out there. I'll just let everybody know that our camps, our in-house theater camps, are doing great. We've had a bunch of kids come in. This is our third week, and we're actually doing a play called Jasper and Deadland, something that I wrote a while back. And the kids are taking part of that this week for the next 2 weeks. And then they're doing a presentation at the end of the 2 weeks in which they will be videotaped and everything sent to their parents. So like I said, last week was sort of dance concentrated, and the week before that was Shakespeare. So, and they've actually, it's been really great. They've been able to be creative and sort of create their shows. So it's not just something that it's been necessarily handed to them. They've actually gone out and done a really, really great job in sort of being able to create their own shows. And also, you know, I want to give a big shout out to Lakeisha Green and to Peggy Mitchell. The two of them have done such an outstanding job. Peggy's the director of education, and Lakeisha is helping out with actually part of the education department and is sort of running the camps. And the two of them have just been outstanding. And the camps have gone really well. And so we're really, really proud of them, proud of all the stuff that we're doing. We're extremely safe. All the kids wearing masks all day long. We're all used to it now, so it doesn't seem like it's that big of a deal to the kids. We get temperature checks every day. We wash our hands. So it's a really safe environment, but I have to say it's been really touching to see the kids come in, ask a lot of questions, and do such a great job. So the other thing I want to talk a little bit about, you know, theaters in general are sort of struggling, and you know, we're sort of doing our own sort of our pitch and drive to sort of raise money for our own theater. If you find it in your heart to donate, you know, it's extremely important, not only for the theater community, but the community that sort of surrounds a theater, especially a theater like Red House. If you don't know, the Red House Arts Center is downtown Syracuse. So it's when people come to see shows at Red House, it's sort of a ripple effect. You know, it affects the restaurants around Red House. It affects the parking garages. It affects the bars. It affects everything. So when the theater's dark, it's actually affecting everything. And so we really want to bring theater back as soon as possible. So we need your donations. Please go to theredhouse.org and give. It can be anything. It could be $1. It could be $2, $5. Whatever you have would be greatly appreciated. And we hope to get theater back real soon. And, you know, we're working on it. We're talking about it every single day. And we're hoping to have something hopefully for the spring of 2021. We're planning our 21-22 season as well. And we're also trying to figure out what the sooner, the better. The sooner we can get back in safely, and we're going to do whatever we can to make sure that we are safe and we'll be back in business. So tonight is I think is going to be a pretty cool, it's sort of something different that we haven't done yet on Red Talks. And we're going to do a play, actually. So Serge Kushnier wrote this as a film, and it's also been done as a radio play, and now it's going to be done as an online play. He's sort of adapted to all three things. And so we're going to do that tonight live, which I think is going to be kind of cool. We've been rehearsing for the past couple of days, and we've got some really talented actors. Jeremy Kushnier, who and Jeremy and I go all the way back to Footloose. That's right. Jeremy and I were in Footloose together many, many years ago. I actually understudied Jeremy, and I have to say I'm still hurting from that show, and I'm hurting because Jeremy was such a good dancer, and I had to try and do the things that he did, which were virtually impossible. Let's not talk about that. And Paul Nolan, another really talented actor who I've a big fan of and seen in many, many shows on Broadway. And a local favorite, Steve Gamba, who's done a ton of stuff for us. You know, he's going to be reading with us as well tonight. And so, and then we're going to do a little talk back afterwards. So sit back and watch the show. We'll do a little talk back. We'll talk about the creation of the play and how it adapts to online. And and we also want to get your feedback. So if you guys want to, please, whatever platform you're on, whether it's on YouTube or Facebook Live, please, you know, send us your comments and or ask questions to any of our actors or to Serge, and we can definitely hopefully have a nice discussion about the play. I will say, many of you kids are out there, there's some language in the play. I just want to say that out front. If you don't like some language that might be a bit offensive to you, or if you're just maybe, you know, leave the room or cover your ears when someone starts to say something that starts with certain letters. But I just want to warn everybody, you know, please, there will be some language on it. So if you are watching, just be aware. And if it's a little bit too much, you know, you can always turn the sound down and come back for the talk back and we'll tell you what it was about. Anyway, so thanks so much for joining us. Please go to theredhouse.org and donate. Like I said, no donation is too small. And we thank you for joining us every week. Next week's going to be Rock Camp because we're getting into Rock Camp, which is my favorite of all the kids' camps. All year is Rock Camp, seeing all the kids running around with sticks and guitars and basses. It's just awesome. All right, here we go. Without further ado, here is the play Will, written by Serge Kushnier, starring Paul Nolan, Jeremy Kushnier, and Steve Gamba.
You're late. Turn on your microphone. No, I can't hear you, jackass. Turn on your microphone. Microphone!
I hate this goddamn thing.
Oh, that's a fresh take.
Shut up. Where are you?
In the basement. Becky's still sleeping upstairs.
Oh, what a princess.
Shut up.
Where's the guy?
I don't know. I think he has. I don't think he has to be here for this. He just set up the meeting.
His job is to just set up a meeting he doesn't have to show up for. We could have done that ourselves. Who pays for this?
Dad's estate. I don't know.
Crooks.
Maybe he does show. Maybe he's just late too. I don't think he has to be here.
He just has to read what it says in the will.
No. I have it here. It came with the.
With Dad?
With the ashes.
They delivered him to you? Why?
It looks like Dad made me his power of attorney.
Oh, of course he did. Well, can we start? How do we start? Did you read that already?
No, I had to wait for you to be on screen. It says, open in the presence of all concerning parties.
That's like saying it's illegal to tear this off on a mattress. Who gives a shit?
Well, if I opened it, I'm sure you would have accused me of lying about something.
Well, how can I tell if you haven't opened it from here? Well, great. I believe you.
I don't give a shit if you do or not. I didn't open it.
Great. So he's in that? That box?
Yep.
It's so small.
It's ashes. What did you expect?
Well, like you knew it was going to be that small.
Yeah, whatever, man. Can we just do this? I have shit to do.
Yeah, big plans. Not leaving your apartment. So much to do. Busy, busy, busy.
I still have a lot to... Look, whatever. The executor guy isn't going to show, so I'm just going to start.
Hey, it looks like that envelope was already opened. So?
It's from a lawyer.
Dad's lawyer?
I didn't think Dad had a lawyer. It's from a lawyer.
Well, it would still be Dad's lawyer if he's writing his will.
Fine, Corey. It's from Dad's lawyer, but it's not a will.
Maybe we should have waited for the guy. If that's not the will, he probably has it.
He didn't have one.
What?
Dad.
What?
No, Dad didn't have a will.
How do you know?
This is literally a paper stating that Dad didn't have a will.
Of course not. Asshole. I'm having a drink.
It's 9:30 a.m.
Yeah, it sure is.
Well, this is interesting.
You are such a loser.
All right, if you don't want to know.
Oh, Dick, fine. What?
Intestacy with no spouse in this scenario, the eldest child shall receive full inheritance.
So what does that mean?
Well, idiot. Since Dad wasn't married anymore, the oldest kid gets everything he had.
Well, idiot, we were born at the same time.
Were we?
No, that's bullshit.
I was born on September 17th at 11:23. What time were you born again?
Screw you, there's no way that counts.
There can only be one person getting the inheritance in the event there's no will, and there is no will.
I can't even see that.
I just texted it to you. What time were you born? First paragraph. In the event that there's only one...
I see it. I'm reading. Shut up.
I'll send you all the pages once I'm done.
7 minutes. Are you fucking kidding me? I get screwed out of dad's money over 7 fucking minutes?
7 beautiful minutes, kiddo.
Fuck! I never thought I could hate this family or my dad more, but... Waking up before 9 and having to download this fucking program for a meeting where dad, the dude doesn't even show just to talk to you, then I found out I get absolutely nothing.
Whoa. Who says you get nothing? I get to decide what happens to his stuff.
Screw you, Alex. We both know you're not going to give me anything.
You don't know that.
All right, split everything with me.
Split? But what makes you think you deserve half? Like, what have you done for the family? When have you ever taken any responsibility? No, this is just one of life's unexpected lessons.
See, I knew you would start with this shit. You love holding things over my head, and this is the goddamn first prize and guilt trip holding above head things.
All right. Tell me what you've done.
What have you done?
I helped Mom find her place in Florida. I figured out how to ship all of her crap out there. I sold the LeBaron.
How does any of that have to do with Dad?
Stuff for the family.
Mom and Dad have been divorced for 30 years. You didn't do shit for Dad.
Neither did you.
Exactly.
Exactly. Look, I'll see what I have to sign, and then I'll let you know if there's any other paperwork for you, the youngest child.
Right, yeah, sure, whatever, Alex. Great, you get to decide what I get. You get to be in control, your favorite fucking position. Goddamn fucking control issue bullshit. Fuck. I don't need his shit anyway. I have a great thing going, and I never had his help. Take it all, man. How much could he possibly have anyway, schmuck?
Oh, shit.
Oh, come on.
Oh, fuck, Jesus.
That good?
Shh.
Okay, I lied. I need the money. If it's that good, just share a little. Whatever you need, I'll help with all the paperwork. Selling is dump. Does he still have that ugly trailer? I bet people are in the market for a trailer these days. We'll split all the work. I'll help this time.
Corey, shut up!
You're fucking unbelievable. So goddamn greedy.
Oh, this can't be right.
Yeah, you're telling me.
Dad didn't have anything.
Oh, so what? You're not getting as much as you thought? You greedy bastard. You're not going to share a penny with me now.
No. He didn't have anything except mountains of debt.
What?
He owes on everything.
Oh, great. So neither of us get anything. Now, like, that's something new.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
I'll take it easy over there so you don't get anything. You bury that box in your garden and we go back to our lives. Who gives a shit? Thank you for nothing, Pop. Oh, wait, wrong way. Thanks for nothing, Pop. Is it hot down there?
No, Corey, it doesn't work like that. I still get all the inheritance, but it's the debt.
What? What are you talking about?
Jesus. Take a look at your text. Bottom of the page. That's the amount I owe.
So... You get all this, or like you owe this? Woo! Wow! You know, you were right, pal. You won. The eldest child wins. I'm gonna have to print this out and frame it. You know, you could use a drink. You have anything over there? Well, remind me to send you a bottle.
Shit, I can't. This isn't fair.
You know, Alex, this is just one of life's unexpected lessons. And what have we learned? Don't be a dick to your brother, because karma might come back and crap in your cornflakes.
I am so fucked, man.
Yeah, well.
Look. You're right, all right? You were right.
I know.
I was being greedy, but it wasn't for me.
Well, that just doesn't make sense. You can't be greedy for someone else.
No, I mean, I was planning on taking most of the money, if there was money.
Yeah, you're unbelievable. You're admitting it. And even now, I should record this. How do I do that?
Yeah, I needed it. I admit it. I needed it more than you.
You don't know what I need.
Come on. You fall on your feet. You've always figured something out. You never ask mom and dad for money. You're fine. You've always been fine.
Yeah, well, I still could have used it.
Yeah, well, I needed it.
You don't need it. You have a job. You have a great job.
Nope.
No?
I had a job.
Oh, you got laid off too? So what? A lot of people did. You'll get another job. You must have saved.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, so great. You'll have your savings and unemployment, I assume. Don't give me a sob story about not having a job.
It's not about me. It's Becky.
Oh, that prize. Big deal. She'll just have to trade in the Mercedes for a Honda. I'm sure she can do without the silver spoon. You guys can't exactly go for fancy dinners anytime soon.
She's pregnant. I'm gonna have a baby. I lost my job, and now we don't have health insurance. All the savings have been going to the hospital bills, the ultrasounds. I'm so fucked. I'm going to be a dad, and I already can't afford to feed my kid.
I'm going to be an uncle.
Congratulations.
Uncle Corey, is it a boy, or...
We don't know. We're waiting.
Oh, well, that's just stupid. You should find out. I'd want to know. Colors and stuff.
Hey, Dick, did you forget I'm screwed here? We're not worried about what color the nursery is.
Alex! You are going to be a dad. Holy shit.
Yeah, a deadbeat dad, just like our dad.
When's she due?
Supposed to be next week.
Next week? Wow, you really weren't going to tell me, huh?
I didn't think you'd care.
I do.
Sorry.
Well, I'm not busy next week. Is it cool to come? Maybe I could drive down. I've been self-quarantined for like 2 months. Maybe to just see the kid after it pops out from like the porch or something.
Oh. Yeah. I mean, Becky still hates you, but you could come, I guess.
Oh shit, Becky's gonna be there? Look, send me the rest of the pages. We'll just deal with this.
What?
Hey, here was our deadbeat dad. We'll just deal with this, the debt, together. My niece or nephew's going to be fine.
Really? Oh. Thank you so...
Yeah, all right, shut up.
Okay, but... Thank you. No, I'll put the rest of the paperwork in one file. I gotta figure out what to do with his ashes, too. He sure as hell isn't getting a fucking plot at the cemetery.
Wow, that is a lot of debt. I say you just flush him down the toilet.
My luck, he'd clog it, and I'd have to pay a plumber to fix it.
Oh, great. Looks like our guy's finally here. Nice of you to finally join us. We're cutting your rate.
I'm sorry?
No, we already read it. Don't worry about it. Thanks, though.
Oh, I'm not sure what you mean. I received this meeting invitation from Mel Blofus and Associates.
You're not Mel?
Sorry, who are you?
I'm Lon.
This is about William Kozlowski. Now, maybe there was some mix-up.
No, I think I'm supposed to be here.
Were you a friend of our dad or something?
Your Will's sons?
Yeah. Alex.
Corey.
Wow! It is so great to meet you guys!
You knew our dad?
Yeah, well, yeah, I guess you could say that, yeah.
He never mentioned Alon, but then again, we weren't exactly close.
Oh, that's too bad. Well, this is weird way to do this, but, well, it's a weird time.
Dad was gay.
No, that's not...
Corey, no. Shut up.
Well, I'm not sure how to put this. Your father was married to my mother before he married yours.
Huh?
Well, Mom never wanted to talk about it, and, well, I'm guessing he didn't either.
Wait, what?
He left right after I was born. I just always wanted to know more. I knew he existed, but then I found out about you two when I was, like, I don't know, 20 or so. And Mom said just leave it alone, and I respected that, but, well, now she's gone, and so is Dad.
What?
When I got the call from Mr. Blofus, I mean, I was sad for you guys, but I was so excited that I was going to get the chance to finally meet you. Can you believe it?
I can't?
I'm your half-brother. Bill was my dad, too.
Jesus Christ.
No! Can you believe it? We're meeting like this for the first time on a computer?
I can't.
So you're our...
I'm your big brother, Lon.
Lon, can we get your mailing address?
What's that?
We just have a bit of paperwork that we'd like you to take a look at. I think it pertains to you more than it does to us.
Welcome to the family, bro.
Hey! I'm the only one that can hear a plot.
Oh, there I am. I was like talking, and then I realized that I'm not on. Great job, guys. Serge, tell me about the history. Yes, congrats.
Thanks.
Congrats, man.
Great job, guys.
Yeah, great job. Great job.
Thank you.
This is sort of our new normal. This is sort of like what we do now. But what is, Serge, tell me about the play. Tell me about how this all started. Why you wrote this, film is based on?
I initially wrote it, I think like 8 years ago or 9 years ago, right before I was moving back to New York from Toronto. And I was driving through Stratford, Ontario, actually, on my way to go to New York to move back to the city. And I written this right before, and at the time, Jeremy was doing a show in Stratford, as well as Paul. We had a day that we could work together and shoot this thing, and we knocked it out with my good friend Nick Seguin, who shot it with me. And then it was maybe my second or third short film. And so forgot about it. It's on Vimeo if people want to check it out. It's something that we made a long time ago. And then about a year ago, a friend of mine, named Lauren, asked me if I had anything that would work as a radio play. And I thought, well, this could potentially work as a radio play. So I took the old script and I adapted it into a radio play. And then we made that with a couple of other friends of mine. And that's up on my website as well, if you want to listen to it. And then all of this happened, the pandemic happened. And, struggling to find things to write that will actually get made, trying to figure out, keep your head above water, try to keep working, try to keep moving forward. And Jeremy, out of nowhere, said, well, why don't you turn Will into a virtual play? I've been doing these virtual plays with Hunter over at the Red House, and maybe Will would work like that. And he was right. I adapted it again, and here we are.
Here's a question. Do you think that there's a future for this kind of stuff? Like I said, Jeremy, we've done, and Steve, two of these now. This is our third one that we've done. Obviously we're missing the audience, which is the tough part, because you're not getting the sort of the immediate feedback, and you're not shooting like a film, because we're doing it in order, in real time, as you would do a play. Do you think there's a future for this, or do we think that, because I know we're trying to adapt to this new world. Mm-hmm. Do you want to write more of these?
I don't know. I like this. This was fun. This turned out great. But obviously missing the audience when it comes to live theater is really tough. I've been trying to figure out what to write. I've actually written an animated, adult animated series that I'm pitching around right now. And that kind of seems like maybe the next thing to kind of focus on writing wise, but I love the theater. I grew up in the theater. I was an actor, just like my brother, for a long time. I was on Broadway at the same time as him. When he was doing Rent, I was doing Hairspray. And I miss that, and I miss the theater community. I wrote a play a couple years ago that he directed, and I want to get back there, but who knows? No one knows what's gonna happen. This worked out great, but I really do miss the audience.
Yeah, Jeremy, what's it like to do these? Obviously,
brother?
Yeah, what's it like to be Serge's brother or this?
So
there you
horrible.
Go. There
wow.
we go.
Jesus,
there.
Look at that. Look
a little
at
Photoshop
that.
Would have been nice on that, Hunter.
I need to get some.
He took all my gray out. I don't know how he got that. did that.
Oh, yeah. Man. Yeah. So what's, yeah, we've done these a bunch, a few now. I mean, what is it? Obviously, this is it's not as satisfying, but it's at least something. At least we're doing something.
Yeah, no, I think, you know what? Look, the thing that I really have gotten to like about these is that it's different. It's never going to compare to doing live theater, but what's so great about you and places like Red House and writers like Serge and these great actors is that this is what we do. This is what we do, right? Like, it's sort of, you sort of just MacGyver whatever kind of situation you do, and I think I said this last, did we do a talk back last time? I can't remember.
Yeah, we probably did.
But who knows? I really like the fact that we're still doing it, that, like, you know, screw the quarantine, we're gonna figure out a way to tell stories. And I think this is a really interesting way to do it. I've watched a couple, I've been in a couple, and I don't know. I'm looking at the comments on the side, and a couple of people seem to have liked it. So I think three of them are my mom. But,
Please.
No, I really do think that it's, I think it's a really cool idea. And I actually kind of like the idea of, like, how do we solve a problem like Maria right uh-huh. now? Like, how do we right now do something different? How do we get to tell stories right now? And this is one of the ways. And I think it's fun.
I think the interesting thing about being a writer right now is the challenge, and you know, writing something like this, for example, I think a lot of the time people write about the medium, right? About the fact that we're on Zoom and we're talking about Zoom and this is Zoom. Isn't this crazy that it's Zoom? Whereas I kind of wanted to, because if this is going to be the new normal for a while, I wanted to write a story that wasn't about Zoom. We are on it, or not Zoom, or whatever streaming platform you're using. But it's a way that people are connecting, and this is a story about two brothers that haven't connected in a long time and now are forced to connect because of their deceased father, and they have to do it over this medium. But it's not focused on that. The story is about them and their relationship and you know, where they are now in their lives. So I think it's interesting because people are doing a lot of work on their psyche and on their minds and on their hearts and spending a lot of time with their own thoughts. And so I think there's a lot of stories there about people thinking and trying to connect and trying to, you know, still have those relationships with their friends and family, but just through a different way.
Yeah. I think what's interesting is that we're sort of adapting to this new world in a way. Like, I think a couple months ago it was like, well, how do we, you know, do Zoom? How do we, I mean, this is StreamYard, and thanks to the people at StreamYard, this
yeah,
is like,
awesome.
Oh my God, StreamYard's amazing. Cause then I can do crazy things like this, or I can do this. Hi guys, do this. I mean, it's just awesome. I mean, StreamYard is really, sort of, it just turns you into like a TV producer, you know, like the click of, you know, just with one click. But what's interesting though is watching us sort of adapt. Like I said, we've had the kids in all week, and how they're sort of adapting to, because we sort of relate to each other with masks on. We relate to each other on Zoom. So that, to me, now we've gotten used to it. Like 2 months ago, we were like, what is these? How do we talk to each other with masks? How do we do these things on Zoom? So it's so much a part of our world that I watched the first week with the kids, and they were doing Shakespeare, and I forgot about the masks after a while, because that's our world, and they don't even care, you know. I think about masks. Like, if I was a kid, I would love to wear a mask.
I was actually just talking about that with my other brother this morning. We have another brother. Actually, my brother Bryce did the music.
That was the
intro. That was some of the original music from the short. And we were just talking about the fact that we like going to the grocery store if we have to, and covering up our faces and wearing sunglasses, because you kind of feel like a ninja or like Batman or something. No one knows who you are.
No, my favorite one, as soon as they said you had to wear a mask, I went out and got bandanas, because like it's like my Western saloon hold up the train. I was like, so yeah, I like the bandana. So Paul, what's this like? Have you done any of these things like this online? Any of these plays?
No, I haven't. I did StreamYard hosted for Daddy Longlegs reunion a couple months ago, and I found it worked really well, surprisingly well actually. And the only other really theater-related thing I've done online was I taught a master class the other day, which is my first master class, and it worked exceptionally well. So yeah, I haven't been doing these readings. I think I'm doing another one next week.
I'm a big fan of Daddy Longlegs and Paul.
Yeah, great team that was.
Yeah, loved it. And Gamba, have you been doing? I know you did Still Waiting and Waiting for the Host. Have you done other ones?
I did just a reading through Rarely Done. We did a reading of Steel Magnolias with an all male cast, which was kind of interesting. It was kind of fun. But other than that, yeah, it was we did just like a Zoom.
Explain.
Room. Well, it was just I actually played Malin, and there were, it was just an all male cast. We had who else was in it? Nick McClain was Shelby. And local actors. It was quite fun. And then the next week they did the same thing with a traditional female cast. That's the only other stuff that I did with you at Red House. That's the only other thing that I've done. So.
And what do you think? How do you? I mean, obviously, again, this is not performing live, but I mean, what's it like for you? Like, this is your third one.
Yeah, I mean, it's the first one was a lot. I don't want to say more fun, but the first one was fun because we didn't know what we were doing. And it was just the way that we screwed everything up all the time was just funny. So we had a lot of fun with that. But now we've kind of, got the groove. I mean, I enjoy it. It's doing something in the interim while we wait this out until we can get back on stage and actually be physically together. But I wonder if this is going to, when regular live theater does get back into the swing of things, if this might morph into something, like these Zoom plays and stuff might. I don't know how that would work. I'm not a big tech guy, but I mean, I think there's potential there for it to become something like a new medium, if you will. I don't know. Maybe I don't know.
Yeah, maybe like a combo, something live and something on. Yeah, I mean, Jeremy, like, how do you I mean, that's a good question. Like, how are we going to be on the other side? Like, what do you think is going to be the future when we get to the other side of all this?
Wow.
What do you hope for us to be on the other side of all this?
I mean, I guess just better, right, than we were. I don't know. It seems, you get inside these events. I have equated this with 9/11 before, because I remember being in the middle, and Serge and I were together during that in New York, and I remember being in the middle of that and thinking that life was never ever going to be the same again after this, and it wasn't. But we found a way to sort of continue with our lives. I remember thinking, like, who's going to want to come to New York now? Like, who's ever going to come back to this city and see theater? And I think that we're all talking about that right now too. But hopefully smarter minds will prevail, and smaller minds like mine will just continue to do Zoom plays.
Well, if anyone out there, if you want to ask any questions or if you have any comments, Lakeisha is giving us a lot of great comments. Lakeisha is one of our, she works with the education department, and she's excellent. She's giving us
a lot Lakeisha.
Of comments. So if anyone wants to give us some more comments, we'd love it. And if you want to donate, please go to theredhouse.org and please donate and help all the theaters, actually, because all the theaters around the country are not doing so well. So any money that you can give to the arts is helpful. And the arts, just like I said, it's not just about the theater. It goes beyond that. It's a ripple effect. It goes to your kids. It goes to the businesses around it and the economy. So actually the arts will help your community. So
and I'll ditto. I want to ditto what Hunter said about, and specifically about Red House, because I did a show there last fall, winter. And it's such a great theater. And Syracuse is a great town, but it really, I think, and speaking with a couple of different restaurant owners in the neighborhood and bar owners in the neighborhood, it only makes that neighborhood more vibrant and more accessible. And there's people coming to do theater, and the staff at Red House is great. And what they do with education is amazing, but also the actual space is so fantastic. I can't wait till we're through this, so that we can get back into that, so I can get back into that space and do something else, because there's like the it's such an amazing, just a physical space is so amazing. And then also the audiences were really smart and really ready for cool theater. So they're there, Hunter, man. Hopefully this will reach some people that have that aren't being hit by this pandemic financially as hard as others, and maybe can help get this, keep this, because I really think it is a jewel in that city as far as what it's going to do, what it does for the city, both financially and also just artistically. It just you guys are really lucky to have people like Hunter out there, who is smart and funny, but also just like willing to take some chances and also to challenge this audience. You know, I said the same thing when we did God of Carnage, which was the play that we did out there, which was a challenging play, and people thought, well, this audience is not going to get it, this audience is not ready for this, and Hunter said, I think you're wrong, and did it, and they loved it, and we had such a great time, we had such great audiences and such great response.
Yeah, I think we over we sort of dumbed down our audiences. I mean, and I'm just saying here. I'm just saying, like, we keep thinking that we need to spoon feed them. Like, people who are there's a lot of intelligent people out there who want to see really cool things. Yeah. And you know, that's part of the I sometimes think we think of them as being stupid. Yeah. And they're not.
No, they're your not. Audience is definitely not stupid. They were
no. Great. Serge, let's talk about a little bit about these characters. Were these based off of anyone?
No, I mean, it's funny. I tend to write about
me,
about my brother a lot. I tend to write about relationships between siblings and suburban families quite a bit in my work. I wrote a movie that we shot a couple years ago that Jeremy starred in called The Idea of Manhood. That has a kind of a similar vibe. It's two guys talking about life and relationships and where they are in their lives. But these two characters, I think I read some article somewhere, or I read something on Reddit about someone who went through this, who got stuck with the inheritance of their mom or dad, and it was just tons and tons of debt. And I started kind of going down the rabbit hole, and I thought that would be a hilarious thing for two people that really dislike each other to have to deal with, and the back and forth and where it turns and who's in control, who's in the driver's seat, I thought would be an interesting idea for a play. And hopefully it was.
And we should also let you know that Idea of Manhood is also available to stream on Amazon.
It's on Amazon Prime. It's on Tubi. It's on Apple TV, on Google Play. You can check it all out on my website, which is right here,
right there.
I watched it last night. It's excellent.
Oh, thank you very much, Steve.
Yes, please check that out. That's your other, how many films have you
that's my only feature that I've made so far. I've made a handful of short films. I have a couple other things in the chamber right now that I'm hoping we get to make. Like I said, I wrote a animated adult series, and that seems like the most viable option right now as a way of making things and people actually going back to work. It's quite interesting, actually. It's the first animated thing I've ever written, but learning about the process and kind of what's happening right now in that sector of the industry, where a lot of production houses or places like Netflix and Sony, how they're investing in infrastructure there right now and setting up in-home animation studios for their animators and sending out really great recording equipment for their actors to be able to work from home. And Zoom writer meetings like this are happening. So that's the other thing that I've recently put out. But yeah, the Idea of Manhood is the first feature that I wrote and directed. Jeremy stars in, along with our good friend Carl Beery. So I'd love for people to check that out. And write a review on Amazon. Let me know what you think, even if you hate it.
So, Paul, where are you right now?
I'm an hour and a half ahead of you guys.
Half hour ahead.
Can you explain the math of what? So you're, where are you and what time difference?
Yeah, I'm in St. John's, Newfoundland, which is if for Canadians they understand very quickly what I mean when I say I'm in St. John's, because it means I'm a half hour plus as many time zones backwards ahead of them. So I'm an hour and a half ahead of you guys in New York. And Syracuse. So I'm at my wife's hometown. So we spent the first 3 months of being away from New York seeding the family farm's crop in Saskatchewan, Canada, which is Western Canada. And then when that was all done, we needed a change of scenery. So we flew out here to be with her family.
I love that the Canadians are like, we don't want Americans. Americans are not allowed to come to Canada.
Well, and the Newfoundlanders don't want anyone else. No one's allowed into Newfoundland unless you're a resident or married to a resident or originally a Newfoundlander and out of work. You're not allowed. Even Keeley's brother, who works as an animator in Toronto, He can't come home because he's got a job. So, you know.
No, can you leave? Can you leave and come back, or no? Once you leave, you can't come back?
Yeah, I think I could, because I'm considering going home and harvesting the crop that I helped seed this spring. So the harvest starts in about a month, and you know, it's I love being home on the farm when I can get there, and you know, lucky that I have that to run to.
He's not joking. Like, I've seen him on a
track. I'm not joking.
He's like, I literally have.
Yeah, don't judge him by that outfit right now.
No. Do you like it? Do you like
Is it pink?
Thank you for noticing.
So, how relatable are you to this character, to Corey, or are you not? Or
no, I don't think I'm. I don't have that much anger in me. I've got rage, but I save it for specific moments.
Well, how is it to play? I mean, because both of these are despicable characters in a way. I mean, they're both. I mean, I don't want to say despicable, Serge. I want to just say that they're They're not great guys.
They're not great people.
No.
I love writing bad people.
Is it fun as an actor to play roles like this?
Yes, it's the best. I love it. Every time I've been able to play an asshole or a villain, it's delicious. This kind of gave me whetted my appetite for being interested in, because I love working with Jeremy. Him and I have worked together a few times, and we're very good friends. So you need that kind of trust to get really ugly with people. Otherwise, you walk away at the end of the day and you think, oh, geez, it almost takes more trust than intimacy. And to get, you know, which we found out when I did Slave Play this earlier last fall and earlier in the year, because it gets ugly. And, you know, we were kind of scratching the surface here because we're, you know, doing this with you guys. And, you know, we don't have all the time in the world right now in our COVID-19 moment to rehearse in person and really, you know, get to know these guys inside and out. But, you know, the script's so well written that we just kind of, you could even read it and it kind of comes out. I think it got better every time we read through it. So, I love it. I love playing bad people.
Part of the challenge, I think, for doing these plays on Zoom or on StreamYard, is a bit better than Zoom in doing this is timing. Mm. We talked about obviously timing in the theater is important and making sure the pace is important. Problem is that everyone's working off of different bandwidths. So you're not necessarily reacting to what's been given to you in real time, because things can be given to you at different speeds. Steve, what is that like? I know you've done this a bunch now. How is it dealing with the timing and just dealing with the all the technology that comes with trying to work this out?
I'm kind of a technological moron. So I feel like this platform was a little better than Zoom, because it felt to me on this end that it wasn't so delayed as it has been on Zoom. I didn't feel like, and I felt like there were less kinks in the platform. Like people didn't seem to be freezing up. I don't know. Maybe it was because there were less of us than the other ones. I don't know. I really, it's hard to, when you're not there in person, and it's harder to read the other person. It's harder to get what they're giving you, because when you're in person, you can actually physically feel what they're giving you. And when you're looking through a screen, there's a little more to second guess. So that to me is the challenge. The timing is what it is. I mean, there's really not much you can do about it, because, you know, who knows, you know, you don't know what your internet's going to do. You know, who knows? Like, we could be freezing up in 2 seconds. We don't know. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I think you're right. There is something about the sort of spiritual connection that we have with each other on stage. Like, there's the, when you're in the presence of other people.
Just the ability to reach out and physically touch somebody.
Yeah.
You know, we don't have that. So.
But also there's the energy that you feed off, just the physical energy when you're not even touching each other. You get something. I mean, you'd be on stage where you can feel tension, you can feel emotion, you can feel anger that's coming out of someone else. And that's the part that I think that it's difficult, you know. And you know, you're right, there is the physical touch, because I still feel like, you know, I think it's been 4 months. I don't think I haven't shook a hand. I haven't hugged someone besides my wife in, you know, four months. It's bizarre that we've not had that sort of physical touch with other people. So I do this every time we do a Red Talks. So we just kind of go around and say, you know, the one thing that we've sort of not learned, but sort of the one thing that we'll take away from all this, because as opposed to 9/11, which was, you know, I felt like after 9/11, I was doing a show on Broadway and we came back in 2 days, and, you know, we were there for each other and we could hug each other and cry. And this is different. We're still sort of being ripped apart. And it feels like 9/11 has been 4 months as opposed to, you know, one morning. But what's one thing that you'll sort of take away from all this? Like, from just our time away, creativity, new way of, I mean, I asked you something earlier, sort of similar, but like just on a personal level, is something that you'll take away from this?
I think it's contact, but it's funny because for me, it's not actual physical contact. I actually have found that I talk to my parents more. I talk to my brothers more. You sort of, because you're missing that contact that you used to have every day, just getting on the subway, that you sort of long for that, and then you sort of realize that the specific contexts are the ones that you should be fostering, I guess, and hopefully will continue to do after this. But also just trying to find ways every day to get up and be creative and get through the day, like get from the bed back to the bed again in a healthy way. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm not sure I've completely discovered that, but but every day is just another. Every day is just like, all right, let's get through this one. As opposed to, you know, I think that's for me. That's the biggest thing, is that because we don't know. Like, people keep throwing out these dates, but we really don't know what's going to happen. So to stay sane for me, I just got to know what I'm going to do today.
Yeah,
and then tomorrow I'll figure something out.
Paul, what about you?
Well, I think. Even if there was no concern about money, like, you know, and we all have concerns about when's the money running out, or not only unemployment, but our savings, if we have savings. And, you know, I will say that I've remained fairly privileged through this. You know, being able to go home to the farm and work and have a sense of what I am doing when I wake up in the morning, and having a family who enjoys having me and my wife there. And then after that, coming to her family's place, who I'm convinced they never want us to leave either. But even if money weren't part of the equation, it's surprising how much a sense of purpose is important. I think, you know, I've noticed several of my friends, you know, are feeling fairly dark, and I'm starting to kind of, I'm starting to shift. Into, and I'm trying to figure out how to deal with that, because I, you know, our future, our plans for how to make sense of the world, how to make sense of our everyday and give ourselves some sort of quest is for me quite vital. And I'm trying to figure out how to do that, you know, because we don't know when we're going to be allowed to sing and dance and act in front of people again. And so I don't, you know, we just don't have any sense of where the ground is. And so as my friend Sullivan said to me yesterday, the subtext of us walking around is completely without any ground. So and then a positive takeaway is the massive generosity of people, and the patience we're all going to have.
Great. Steve, what about you?
I think that it's I've come to appreciate kindness a lot more than I have, and because you like what Paul just said, you know, the purpose has been taken away. You know, like in my regular life, I'm a choral director, and I'm, you know, and I'm a teacher, and that's all just overnight literally went away. So like my day was composed of running rehearsals, and then my evenings were composed of either running rehearsals elsewhere or being in a rehearsal, and then all of a sudden I have no purpose anymore. And it's really easy to go to a dark place when that happens. So appreciating kindness and finding the ability within myself to continue to be kind and not just be an asshole to everybody just because I woke up in a shitty mood because I don't have anything to do that day, you know? So just to kind to really, so I feel like if we as humans can do that now, when this is all over and all said and done, how much better off we're all going to be later on.
Serge, what about you?
Yeah, I mean, I kind of would just echo what Paul was talking about is there's just been a lot of lessons. Firstly, just being aware of my privilege and the fact that I'm okay and healthy and have a roof over my head and I don't have to worry about a lot of things that a lot of people are worrying about right now. And trying to internalize that, whether that comes out in my art or whether that just comes out in the way I continue to hopefully grow as a human, that's just what I'm kind of dealing with. When it comes to, it's interesting when this all just began, I was just finishing up a new script and all of a sudden everybody around me, my girlfriend and our friends and family, not physically around me, but people in my world, were all of a sudden living the same life that I've always kind of lived as far as an insular writer's life where you have nothing to do except for be alone with your thoughts. And at first I was like, get the hell out of my space, guys. This is my world. But it's interesting to see everybody kind of deal with the same introspection and kind of starting to, me personally, starting to figure out how I can grow and become a better person through this is actually, I don't know if that's ever going to happen, but that's kind of what this whole thing has kind of done to me.
And what do you love most about writing?
I don't. I hate it.
I hate it. Really?
Oh, I can't stand it. I mean, the thing I love most about writing is when the script's done and then you go, oh God, I did it. I wrote a thing. But writing in itself is hard and it's awful and you feel bad. You feel like you're the worst writer every time you write something new. And then I guess, you know, as soon as something comes out and it isn't a complete bag of garbage and other people tell you that, then that's what I love most about writing.
I agree with you. You know, I've written shows and I've directed shows and I've acted in shows, and there's nothing worse than having something that you've written in front of an audience.
Oh, it's awful.
It's absolutely terrifying.
Yeah. Even this, with not even seeing the audience, I've been, you know, I'm sweating a lot right now.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Well, it's
also really hot in New York.
Well, you're terrific. I think this show, you know, it to be able to also to compact a really sort of interesting story and interesting and these two interesting characters into such a small little, you know, like 20-page script. You know, it feels very complete.
Cool.
For something
you.
That's very short, and so congrats to you.
Thank you very much.
And yeah, continue on, man. Keep writing, and you know, Red House got approved for film. So if you ever want to, you know, we've got That's right. We have space. And if you,
hey, man.
Jeremy can tell you, we have 44,000 square feet of space.
So I got tons of garbage that I can send your way. Don't worry about it.
Well, thanks. Thanks, Paul. Thanks, Jeremy. Thanks,
yeah, thank you,
Steve. Thanks, Serge. Thanks so much for being a part of this, donating your time. All these actors donated their time, and we really, really appreciate you guys being here. And next week on Red House, we're going to spotlight. I will not be here. Actually, Peggy Mitchell will be hosting. So she's going to be running StreamYard, and she's going to do a great job, I just know. And we're going to be highlighting our next camp, which is Rock Camp. And like I said before, it's one of my favorite camps because it's all the kids. They're writing songs. They're learning how to play. I mean, they're playing stuff. They're writing. It's just a really, really cool thing. So if you got a kid out there who wants to be a rock star, send them to Rock Camp. You can get more information if you go on our website at theredhouse.org. And you can actually check out all the things we have going on. We have Littles Camp. We have Circus Camp. We have tons of camps. In fact, I got so excited. I want to do Circus Camp. Who does not want to do Circus Camp, right? So please check it out. And also, stay tuned. We will have some new information coming up shortly once we sort of get guidelines from New York State about how we can proceed as a theater. Right now, we're not allowed to perform until Governor Cuomo allows theaters to open up and have an audience. And when we do, we're going to make sure that we're very, very safe. So stay tuned. Keep watching Red Talks every Tuesday at 6:30 now. We're at 6:30 every Tuesday. Please check us out. And like I said, next week will be our Red Talks for Rock Camp. Thank you so much. We love our Syracuse theater community, and we can't wait to have everyone back in the theater again. And have a great night, guys.